כן, כן, אבל אנחנו קוראים את זה.
כן, היה שם
התמונה שלו. לא, אתם לא עושים את זה, זה בוקר. לא, לא, אתם לא עושים את זה. חיביתי, הזקתי, נסתדר.
אם לא היה כאן, אז הייתה בעיה.
היה בעיה, כשאתי בחיבור.
Okay, so first, first of all, the class in the week of, the class is supposed to be on 22nd of December, right? The one in the Hanukkah week. So it will not be in Monday, it will not be on the 22nd, it will be either Wednesday or Thursday. I still don't have a final schedule, but I think today or tomorrow I'll send you the final time for this class. So that's about the 22nd of December class that's cancelled, and instead of it, it'll be somewhere in the Wednesday, in 24th or 5th. Now, next week, another thing surprisingly came up, and so next week class is also, is not also, but next week. Next week class is really cancelled, and I don't think we can find another time to compensate for it. But I don't think we'll have to. So we'll see where we stand, like two weeks before the end of the semester. So next week is cancelled. I'm going abroad for 3 days. It's a surprise. It came. It's an urgent matter. And yeah, sorry. Okay. So next week. The 17th, right. No class. So if you know of anyone who's taking this class is not here right now, please tell her or he. Okay. Yeah. Sorry. Let's start with answer this question page together. So you tried it at home? Okay, so you have your answers with you, in front of you. Okay, so the first question. In what cellular functions is the adenosine base involved? Stabilizing structure, information storage, energy storage, or none of the above, or any possible mixture between the three? And I think it's not the best time to answer this question because I think we haven't gone on all of these functions yet, but let's do it anyway. So, yeah. True. We already described it as the energy coin, so it's energy storage. That's true. But also, what do you think? Any other information storage should be there as well, because it builds the RNA molecule. And we go over the transcription and translation machinery, I think, the second hour of today's class. So we'll see it more accurately. What about so these two are correct. B and C are correct. What about A? With the adenosine base itself. So that we will call stabilizing structure. Okay, first of all, might be. And second of all, I think the ribosomal RNA should be considered as, I don't think, it should be considered as stabilizing structure in the ribosome. So this question is not the best one. I think we dropped it. We did it. It was in an exam in two or three years ago, and I think we dropped it because of the A dilemma. But I think A is true as well, A, B, C, so all G.
Why is B true?
What is?
Information storage.
So it stores information in way of the sequence of nucleotides.
Right,
that A is one of them, yeah?
So the base and the nucleotides, that's added, right, not adenosine? Are those different things?
These are different things. We haven't really go into these details, but the adenosine is the adenine, and together with the sugar base, so that's we call the adenosine, and the whole thing together with the phosphate groups is a nucleotide. But okay, maybe a semantic thing here. I'm not sure. So if you consider it as, you know what, it doesn't really matter in this case. I think either adenosine or adenine here if I would have changed it. So still, I think A to C, the three are correct. Okay, but the main thing is that we went over these three functions now and we understand them better. Okay, now we have a list of chemical building blocks and macrostructures, and you have to match each of the macrostructure with one of or more of the building blocks from which it is built. Okay, so RNA is built of what? Nucleic acid, cell membrane is built of phospholipids, right? Amino acid builds. Where do we have it? Polypeptides, right? Phospholipids we said already, and polysaccharides are built of monosaccharides. And nucleic acids, by the way, if we just look at these terms, so it builds two structures, DNA and RNA. Right. Polysaccharides are built of monosaccharides. Monosaccharides, are they the sugar part of DNA and RNA? Would we call the monosaccharides there? I'm not sure. So I'm not sure. Might be a good point. I'm not sure. Sorry? Sure, yeah. So I know what, I'm not sure. Okay, are they really monosaccharides? Yeah, they look like monosaccharides. Yeah, either Wikipedia or ask a classical, old-fashioned biologist somewhere here in the building. I'll look it up. I'm not sure. Might be a good point. So, okay, I'll get back to you with this question. All right, question number three. What type of chemical bond exists between, if you put sodium inside water? And here you have only one option, right? So it's true that van der Waals interactions, we can't exclude them. But still, what's the most, not intuitive, but the primary bond will be ionic bond. True.
Isn't it also, isn't it a polar bond because the Na attaches to the negative end of the...
So then what would we say?
So I would say, I would call it hydrophilic, not that that's the name of a...
But it's true.
Red water is
an ion. Ionic bonds. First of all, it was given as an example in the slide. Now, is the definition precisely between two ions? Between an ion and something else? Let's look it up together. Sorry, you have to go with me through all these folders. 1 minute. Yeah, it's true, but still, yeah, I'm not sure why is this question still in. Again, I will have to look it up and see if there is some semantic inaccuracy there. Not that semantic, actually, pretty much biologic. Okay, I'll look it up, as well. Okay, maybe the fourth question will be relevant. Monosaccharides differ from one another by the number of carbons in the molecule, by the bond conformation around the carbons, by the ring size, when a ring structure exists, because it's sometimes linear, as you recall, by the polysaccharides that they build. Right, the whispers of all of the above are correct, all of the above. This is how we describe them. All right, these all four parameters can discriminate between different monosaccharides. Okay. Right. Okay, let's continue and finish the protein structure and function chapter. And we stopped right before starting the purification, detection, and characterization point. And we said that in order to study a protein, its function and its structure, we have to isolate it, purify it first. And only then it can be studied in vitro systems. And the two most widely used characteristics for separating proteins are by their size, defined as either the length all the mass, it differs between different systems, and the binding affinity for specific ligands. Proteins, as you recall, bind different molecules, which we call them ligands, and by their binding affinity, we can also isolate one from the other, or from a mixture of proteins. Okay, so let's start with simplification, which is the most rough procedure that we have in the lab. So we usually start with a mixture of cells, actually. Either start by harvesting cells from a cell culture or taking a tissue from after we sacrifice an animal, either a brain or a liver or a muscle, right? And then the first step would be to do a homogenate of cells simply by mechanically grind the cells with a mixer. Okay, and then the cell homogenate is poured into a test tube and can be centrifuged with a different protocols that will differ in duration or in speed of the centrifuge. And at the end, a sediment and a supernatant will be formed, mishka v'tarchif in Hebrew. The sediment will usually be composed of debris of cells and sometimes even intact cells, and in the supernatant will find nucleic acids and proteins. Okay, the second step we can take, which is a more subtle one, is pouring the supernatant alone into another test tube that will have a sucrose gradient in it. So it has a sucrose matrix that goes from being less concentrated to more concentrated towards the bottom of the test tube. And again, centrifuge with some protocol. Now, the more heavy the particles, the more would they penetrate into or towards the bottom of the test tube, and they will be found more in the concentrated fraction of the sucrose
again, the outcome is that the shorter the the protein, the more would they be found towards the cutoff. And this really discriminates proteins up to the level of single amino. So we can determine the precise molecular weight. Again, an emphasis in here, any difference in shape is destroyed and you're only left with the length of the protein. Okay, so a question, if you have a protein that's filled of more than one polypeptide, why there are some there are some proteins to which that have quaternary structures that describe it, that have more than that are composed from more than one polypeptide. So for these proteins, what would you expect would be the outcome in this kind of method? Sorry? You'll see, yeah, right, but in the vertical axis, so we'll see a couple of them because we run doing just the first right here. So this is sort of just one, you're looking at one sample. So it's true, you will have what biologists call these lines, the bends in the gel. So we'll have multiple bends because the quaternary structure was break down into the single units that were there. Okay, I think it's worthwhile to see this short list. For anyone who already performed Western blot, I guess it's not the most amazing thing to see, but for those of you, this is the first time to hear about the electrophoresis,
SDS polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis is a powerful tool which resolves proteins according to their molecular weights. Because proteins differ in size, shape, and charge, a protein sample is first denatured with the anionic detergent SDS. When the sample is heated, the SDS molecules bind to the proteins and cause them to unfold. The denatured proteins become uniformly coated with negatively charged SDS molecules, so they all have a similar shape and charge-to-mass ratio. If a protein is composed of several subunits, the SDS not only unfolds the protein, but also dissociates the protein into its individual polypeptide chains. The mixture of denatured proteins is then transferred from the tube and loaded into a well that has been cast in the top of a polyacrylamide gel. In an electric field generated by a power supply, the negatively charged polypeptides migrate through the gel toward the positive electrode at the bottom of the gel. The migrating polypeptides are retarded by the tangled network of polyacrylamide. Smaller polypeptides travel more easily and quickly through the pores in the network than do larger polypeptides. Because the polypeptides have similar charge-to-mass ratios, the distance they travel through a gel is dependent only on molecular weight. Based on this principle, proteins are separated according to their sizes, with low molecular weight proteins having greater mobility than high molecular weight.
When you put proteins in pH 3, for instance, most proteins will have some
charges distributed upon them, either positive or negative. And then each person will have, when you shift it from 3 or 4 towards 10, some charges will be gained, others will be lost. And at a certain point, you will have a net charge of 0, a neutral charge. And in this spot, if what you have here is an electrical force again, you will have 0 force, because you will have no charge inside an electric force, and hence no electrical force will be induced here, or the protein will not feel any force, and will stop shifting, right? Will stop moving. And this is the stop. This is the point which this protein will stop, in which this protein will stop, because it is the pH which the protein has net neutral charge. It is the isoelectric point. So this is the first operation. Alright, so that's the first operation. Then you take this axis and flip it in 90 degrees and perform standard electrophoresis as was described in the previous slide. And then you have first operation by isoelectric point, second by mass. So any proteins that were previously at the same spot because they had similar masses, now and had different isoelectric points will now be separated. And then we get these nice blots of proteins, and after sufficient experiments you can say which dot to which protein it belongs, and even try to semi-quantify it by the intensity of the diameter of the sphere. Right? So this is the two-dimensional gel electrophoresis. Okay, liquid chromatography is a group of methods that dissolve proteins based on different parameters, different features such as mass, charge, and binding affinity. It was developed 100 years ago in the German color industry, and then was gradually developed and used for other purposes such as for protein isolation. And the principle in all these methods is the same. We have molecules that interact with some metrics. So in these methods, in all of them, molecules, in our case proteins, are passed through a column. Inside the column you have some metrics or surface as termed here. And then proteins that will interact with the metrics more frequently will be delayed and exit last through the column, whereas those that interact infrequently or less with the metrics will exit less from the column, will exist in the first fraction that you collect out of each point. Now let's see specific examples of gel chromatography. The first one is gel filtration chromatography, which separates proteins by their size. In this case, inside the column you'll find metrics of lots of beads, tiny beads that have tiny grooves scattered around them. And the yellow are big proteins, and the green are the small proteins. And then if the size of the grooves on these beads fit roughly those of the small proteins, they will interact and will be stuck or delayed inside these grooves. And the bigger proteins will exit first. It's a bit counterintuitive. This time, most of these methods do use gravity force as the force that passes these particles through the column, but it's counterintuitive because earlier it was the smaller parts should exit first, right? But you should always remember what the matrix characteristics is or are, and by that decide which molecule exits first. So again, here we have grooves that in which small molecules are stuck or delayed, and hence those that do not interact with the beads exit first. The big ones will be in the second fraction, while the green small proteins will be at the third or later on fraction. Alright, so that's what we just explained. Alright, so that's the first type of liquid chromatography. The second will be ion exchange chromatography, in which proteins are separated on the basis of charges. So this time, same beads, well, different beads, but again, we have beads that compose, from which the matrix is composed, and this time they just have a charge, and they will be positively charged. Usually it's easier to control, and because they are positively charged and negatively charged, proteins will interact them electrostatically more frequently than the neutral or positively charged proteins, which will flow with no interruption through the colon and hence will exit first. Then you might say that we are stuck with the negative proteins inside the colon. So what you do is you add salt gradually in different concentrations that replaces the interactions of the negative proteins and push them out, or what we call in biochemistry, elute them out of the colon. So elute or elution is taking the molecules out of the colon, washing them out. Right? Another, I think the final type of liquid chromatography we'll bring here, affinity chromatography. This time we have antibodies covalently linked to these beads. These antibodies recognize one protein and not another. And so proteins, the attached ligand is an antibody, so the again, something that the protein recognizes, which we can call a ligand in our case, it's simply an antibody that's linked to the bead, and proteins that interact or recognize this antibody will stuck in. And then this time the elution is with an acidic pH, which changes the conformation of either the protein or the antibody, in which case there's no more recognition between the two, and the one that is not covalently linked to the base protein is eluted out. Okay. We have specific enzyme and antibody assays that can detect individual proteins. Okay, so about enzymatic assays, some enzymes are based on the ability to detect loss of substrate or the formation of a product. So you remember a chemical reaction in which you have the loss of reactants and the formation of product, and you can measure or monitor either the one or the other, and either the loss of the reactants or the production of the product, and hence by that deduce the concentration or the quantity of enzyme you had in your test. Some enzyme assays utilize chromogenic substrates, which are easy to measure, which is easy to monitor, which change your color in the course of the reaction. They just start to light up. You can measure it. And if you have an enzymatic, or you want to measure the activity of an enzyme that has no chromogenic substrate naturally, then a lot of synthetic systems were developed that add chromogenic substrate or fraction to existing substrates, and then you have chromogenic molecule that you can check with your or you can check your enzyme under investigation on, and again measure light. Western blotting, I think, is the most common method for determining the existence of a specific protein in any system you can think of. It starts with electrophoresis, the same one we described a couple of slides back. Then you induce a perpendicular electrical force that pass or transfer the proteins from the gel to what we call a cellulose membrane. The first step is required simply to do the second and third steps, which is adding your antibody, so it has to be on a membrane. Then you add a first antibody, incubate with antibody, and wash the excess. So you are left with antibody that recognizes the protein that sits right here on your membrane, not in any other bends or these helices, spheres. So that's the first antibody. Then you incubate and you wash the excess. And then you incubate with the second enzyme, sorry, with the second antibody. That's what's unique in the second and doesn't exist in the first one, is that it's linked to an enzyme. So we call it enzyme-linked antibody, second antibody. And by that we mean that it's an antibody. So here it recognizes some epitope. Epitope is the region on the second molecule that is recognized by the antibody. So it has an epitope on the first antibody. But the enzyme link is this part, this tiny dot right here. It's an enzyme, a protein by itself, that was in the lab linked to this second antibody. And when this enzyme will meet its substrate, which is what you add in the third step, it will cause it to fluoresce or to become chromogenic. Right? So this enzyme, and you don't see anything in the cellulose, and then when you pour your substrate through the hole or on the whole cellulose, you will see, you will get fluorescence only where you had the enzyme. And you will have the enzymes only where you had the secondary antibody, and you will have the second antibody only when you had where you had the first antibody. This will be only where you had the protein that you tried to find. So it's a chain of molecules, but it works. It works beautifully, actually. So Western blot, the most common method. Then when you have your protein on the gel, you will keep it, you have it in the system, and this is what we call a semi-quantitative method, which means basically the biologists don't like to make accurate measurements out of it, although they can and some do, because the intensity of fluorescence that will be here does say something about the amount of protein that was present here, but there are so many steps in the way that not only that linearity is not achieved and you don't really know the scale, although you do can calibrate beforehand if you have pure protein, but you don't really know what do you have instead of nonlinearity. So you can't really say that one sample will have two times more protein than the other one, and that's why we call it semi-quantitative, but you can say that one has more than the other, based on the intensity of the fluorescence you get at the end. This transition? Right. So on the second, you added the second antibody that links, that recognizes the first one, that recognizes the protein. On it, already linked, you have an enzyme. So that's the second one. And then now you just pour substrate that is recognized and changed to become fluorescent by this enzyme. And you don't even have to wash any excess, so you have substrates all everywhere here, but it will only become fluorescent where it will meet its enzyme, which is right here. So you get you will have a light band right here and nowhere else in this membrane.
So only the last step will be to identify the body?
Right. The last step, you will identify the protein. It's here all the way through, but you only see it right here and be able to measure it in the last step. Okay, let's watch this clip as well, just to get the feeling of what happens in a Western blot. Right, part of it.
Immunoblotting combines the superior resolving power of SDS polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis with a highly sensitive antibody binding assay to detect a specific protein in a mixture of different proteins. Proteins are first separated in an SDS polyacrylamide gel. Then, in the blotting step, the proteins are transferred to a sheet of nitrocellulose membrane. The gel containing the separated proteins is placed on the membrane. Protein transfer is done by electrophoresis. In the electric field generated by a power supply, the proteins coated with negatively charged SDS migrate toward the positive electrode. As the proteins migrate out of the gel, they are captured on the membrane because nitrocellulose binds any protein that contacts it. The proteins stick to the membrane in the same positions they had in the gel. Thus, the membrane is a blot of the gel. The gel is discarded, and an inert protein such as serum albumin is then used to coat the membrane so no other proteins will stick. A primary antibody, chosen to specifically bind only the protein of interest, the red one here, is then added. The albumin coating keeps antibody from sticking directly to the membrane. After a washing step, only the primary antibody that is bound to the red protein remains. Several methods are used to detect the antibody-labeled protein. all use a secondary antibody which binds specifically to the Fc domain of the primary antibody. In one approach, the secondary antibody is linked to an enzyme, so its location can be determined by a chromogenic reaction. The enzyme cleaves a substrate to produce a colored product that precipitates onto the membrane near the antibody. The blue-colored spot on the membrane shows the location of the enzyme-linked antibody and thus the position of the protein of interest.
So one last thing to see from this slide is that you have a lot of amplification from one step to another, and hence you can detect really minute traces of proteins, which is really hard to find in other methods. So in Western blot, it's possible. It has a really immense sensitivity.
So when would you use this technique? In other words, it seems that if the antibodies that you're using are already designed to detect specific proteins, so if you already know which proteins are there, why do you need to block that?
Because now you have an extraction of proteins that taken from another experiment you did. You produce this protein based on something you knew already. That's for sure. Either by crystallography or repeated experiments, or either some simple in vivo experiments that are possible. You can read a little bit about that in rabbits, that you can produce antibodies to any target almost that you want. Maybe the battery is off. Sorry. So it is important. Okay. My fault. So you know this protein exists in Aplysia, for instance. It's a very famous model organism for LTP in memory. And now you want to see if it exists indeed in humans, or if it decreases in Alzheimer's patients, or any other question you would like. So we have the antibody in view Western blot. That's one thing.
So if you have a hypothesis that a particular protein is there, but you're not sure, so you try it.
Good description. Right. Exactly. And you can even have a more subtle hypothesis that one protein will be, the level of it will be decreased in one condition compared to another.
Correct. Characterizing.
So, if you want to know the structure of protein, which is a bit similar to our leading to what you just asked, so you have X-ray crystallography. I think it's the optimal system, but quite a tough one, so let's describe it briefly. In X-ray crystallography, a beam of X-rays are passed through a protein crystal, which is really hard to get, and what it sees actually is millions of proteins that are aligned in the same orientation to one another. They have to be like this in order to get a strong enough signal right here after passing the X-rays and getting the scatter or distribution of the X-ray. Okay, and this is what you detect actually, this scatter, and then the mathematical transformation to take you back from here to the protein structure already exists and existed for I think seven decades already. So the really limiting step here is attaining the crystal, which is what people do routinely even today, and maybe it's worthwhile to mention Ada Yonath, the Nobel Prize laureate, from Weizmann, and she succeeded in crystallizing the ribosome, which is a huge, not only a single protein, but a complex of proteins with RNA molecules embedded in them. And while other people failed to crystallize much smaller proteins, she succeeded in doing this crystal by using cryo fast cooling of proteins, and so it's really just—it's like not succeeding on crystallizing something like in the size of a car, and she did it for a whole building or something like that, with the leaf, with all its correct structure intact. So again, so then you have some mathematical transformation to take you back to the structure, and it's considered to be a very accurate experiment, though you still have to validate it by performing specific experiments. The article we will read in 2 weeks from now, it does exactly that. The lab attain the crystal structure for some protein, and then bothers
decade to prove that it's indeed the intact physiological structure. All right, so that's crystallography on one in one word. Let's skip this clip. The second way of attaining a protein structure is with nuclear magnetic resonance. So this time you don't have to have a crystal. You only have to have a concentrated protein solution, and it is placed in a magnetic field, and then you project it with different radio frequencies and read the energy discharges, the energy that is discharged, and that is actually, or its effect on the spin of different atoms. And again, you have very good mathematical procedures to take you back or to predict what is the protein structure that gave that produces this scatter of energy discharge. It has a great limit. First of all, it only works for small proteins, relatively less than 20 kilodaltons. So this is a small fraction of what we are interested in, what exists in nature. And the second disadvantage is that I think it's less considered among biologists a less validated system than crystallography, from what I understand. It's a bit of a soft opinion here. Okay, but again, the great advantage is that you don't have to get the crystal. And of course, the nuclear magnetic resonance people will say that crystals affect the protein structure. And their protein structure, and the crystal people will argue that they worked hard to show that it's indeed the correct structural model. Okay, so this was NMR, nucleic magnetic resonance. So, a word about this chapter. Okay, we started with the four hierarchical layers that exist, structural levels that exist in proteins. They are very commonly used in different descriptions in neurobiology and any other kind of biology. Different processes that change proteins after they are synthesized, two groups of proteins with different functions, enzymes that catalyze chemical reactions, and molecular motors that are responsible for cellular motility. Mentioned a bit about common mechanisms, mainly allosteric mechanisms, so make sure you know what allosteric mechanism is. Again, has a lot of roles in G-protein coupled receptor or any signal transduction that occurs through a membrane. And just now, the different methods we have to purify the text and a bit about characterizing proteins. So, I'll send you the paper that we need to read for next time in email, together with the question page that's already there in the website, but where the whoever doesn't have an access there, so we'll also add the question page for the protein structure and function chapter. In a minute, we'll take a 15-minute break. The second chapter, which we'll do in just 1 hour, is a short one. Anyone who has biological background, I hope it will be the last time I'll stay, but although you're welcome to stay, I'm not sure you would have to do that, because we are going to again put us all in the same line regarding the central dogma of RNA transcription and protein translation, because some people here, it will be the first time for them to hear about that. So this is what we're going to do in the second hour. Sorry. And then, again, if you live, so just take this message with you. There is no class next week. Anyone you meet in the hall that takes this course, please make sure that he knows about it. Okay, so let's take 15 minute breaks and go on. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let's go to... on the fourth chapter from our textbook. Not the whole chapter, so I think any term that is not clear for you after this class, you can Wikipedia it. Do people say Wikipedia it? I don't think so.
You can check it out in Wikipedia. It's good enough for us. It'll be about DNA RNA structure, just a bit more, mostly reminder, and a brief description of transcription and translation. So it keeps turning off when a minute after I turn it off. So
really does that mean that it's the battery? I don't know. You look responsible, so
I
you're not.
Ah,
okay. So you're not responsible. Okay.
Transformation from DNA to RNA is called transcription, Shiatuk, and from RNA to protein is called translation. So, just tell this is the same. Alright. Already now, let's note the different roles that nucleic acids play down this pathway. They store information in the form of DNA and messenger RNA. The M here stands for messenger RNA. This is the copy of the DNA. Whatever is written in the DNA, they are the main sequence interpreters, so they play a part in sequence interpretation as tRNA, transfer RNAs, and they are part of the ribosome. This is the machine that translates proteins, synthesize proteins as rRNA, ribosomal RNA. A bit about where each of these processes takes place. RNA transcription, meaning transformation from DNA to RNA, takes place inside the cell nucleus. So that happens right here. We won't go into details because we'll have a chapter for cellular organelles, but this is basically where it's located. Then the messenger RNA leaves the nucleus to the cytosol, where it is translated to proteins by the ribosome. These gray two spheres are the ribosomes, represent the ribosome. Okay. A reminder about the structure of nucleic acid. So on the 5' end, it's called the 5' because of the position, the carbon position in the sugar, which is linked to the adjacent phosphate. So in the 5' end of nucleic acid, you'll find the phosphate exposed to the environment, and on the 3', you'll find the hydroxyl right here exposed to the environment, and in between adjacent nucleotides, you'll find the phosphate linked via two ester bonds. This is why we call it the D-ester bond, phosphodiester bond. These are the bases here, G, A, C, whatever bases. Let's look a bit in more details on the DNA structure. So it's a double helix, which means that it's a helix that's built of two strands. So each of these strands, the blue and the red one, are one nucleic acid chain covalently linked, and they are linked between them via non-covalent bonds. The sugar phosphate backbone, by that we mean this chain of phosphate backbones, or phosphate, this is what we call the amino acid chain backbone, a bit similar to what we call a backbone in protein. So this region in the molecule is faces towards the environment outside, and the bases face inwards towards the other bases that are from second strand, and so they interact with them, which is what we see right here. And so any interaction with the closed DNA, by closed structure we look at right here, because sometimes the two strands unmeal or dissociate from one another. But right here we look at a closed DNA, which means that it's aligned all the way through. And in this situation, any recognition by a protein or an RNA molecule will occur on these major grooves, or the minor grooves, usually on the major ones, more accessible right here, because they face each other and interact with each other, rather than the backbones, which are really which face outwards. Okay. So the bases project into the interior, and the backbones project outwards. What else? The orientation of the two strands is anti-parallel, which means, so we describe the structure, the 5 between 3 to 5 and the last slide, so the two complementary linked strands actually go, while one goes from the 3rd to the 3 prime end to the 5th, to the 5 prime end, the other goes the other way around, from the 5 prime to the 3 prime end. Okay, the interactions right here in the middle between the bases that are introduced by the two strands. The base pair complementarity is the consequence of size and shape of these bases, and these are mainly, as you see, hydrogen bonds and also van der Waals interactions. And all together we call them Watson-Crick interactions, named after the two researchers that there's a third one, but they are the two there that are mostly remembered, that deciphered this DNA structure, the double helix. So Watson-Crick interaction. Okay, so not only van der Waals and hydrogen bonds, also hydrophobic interactions, also true, stabilize the double helical structure. Okay, double helix, major minor grooves, Watson-Crick interactions, anti-parallel orientation. Okay, usually DNA will look like in the previous slide, which is what you see right here, which is called the B form of DNA. And you can, and by that, but usually it looks like this. By that I mean that it has a specific, you can measure the distance between one strand and another across the major groove or across the minor groove, and it will be relatively the same, about 3.6 nanometer. Will make complete turn, or in other words, you can measure just the distance between these two in any positions here. There's also a compact form of DNA called the A form of DNA, which you see right here, and also this is the alpha helix, right-handed helix. Okay, so 90% of our genome is in a right-handed helix, but you could find sometimes the Z form of DNA, which is a left-handed helix.
Where do you find that?
Yeah, all right, so it's been shown to exist in vitro for many years, and I think the last 5 years or so, people claim to see it in both sides of what we call the transcription bubble. So when you take a DNA and you have to anneal these two strands apart, you have to dissociate them apart. So what you have in the middle will be a transcription bubble. It's sort of a bubble because you have this this bubble-shaped structure. And when you do that, it's similar to if you have two rubbers rounded on each other, and if you try to open a window or a bubble in the middle, then you will have accumulation of tension in both ends, both sides of the bubble, right? If you do that, so more tension will be have to hit to occur here. By tension, I mean there will be point cool hot. There will be there is a word for cool, something that rock. There will be rock, I think, on each other, and more than before you open the window. And it's thought that these two structures, the compact DNA and the left-handed helix, discharge some of the tension that accumulates in these sites. And hence, allows more effective opening of the window during transcription. Was that clear? Because it was with no figure. So this is mainly where we think we see that. The heavy role. Okay, so unlike the alpha helix in proteins, in which the interactions were vertical or parallel to the helix of the structure, if this was the helix in proteins, and the alpha helix, so these were the interactions, right? Hydrogen bond between amino acid, the backbone of an amino acid right here, and then the nitrogen in the amide group right here, and then if you try to bend it like this, in this direction, it'll be quite hard, but for the DNA, where the interactions are horizontal to the molecule axis, this will be the molecule axis, then it's really easy to bend it. And again, not a bug, but thought to be a feature in DNA, and this is usually how it looks like when a DNA binding protein, the one that will usually have some consensus element, it's called the TATA box. So any TATA box containing binding protein will bend the DNA to have more accessibility to the major group right here. But again, so in the alpha helix in protein, it's hard to bend, not like the helices in DNA. Okay. A bit about transcription. So principally, transcription in RNA transcription is divided into three steps, and the first step by itself is divided into three sub-steps, if you want. So the first step is initiation. First, the RNA polymerase, this is a protein complex that will synthesize the RNA based on the DNA template. It scans the DNA, finds the start type on the template strand, which will usually be a promoter sequence on the DNA. Okay, this is still what we call the closed complex, because DNA was not annealed in any region yet. And then the open complex, in which you already have a window or a bubble, transcription bubble, is where the polymerase starts to melt the duplex DNA near the transcription start site. Then you have, okay, this is what we said, the open complex. And then the first couple of nucleotides are inserted based on the DNA template. This is exactly the reaction that's catalyzed by the RNA polymerase. So it says the two phosphodiester linkages of the first, either two or just the first few nucleotides is formed, and this is a quite slow process. Second step is elongation, which is a rapid, really surprisingly and impressively rapid process, one of the most rapid processes is defining the cell, of an addition of more and more nucleotides from the 3' to the 5', down the 3 to 5' side, down the DNA template strand, while melting more duplex DNA, and adding the threading nucleotides. So here and here will be the sites where you have high tension between the two strands, and which you will presumably find the the Z and A forms of DNA. Yes.
When you say rapid, what
about the time scale? Okay, see, I should have brought time scales and really show you that it's really fast. So other than knowing it's fast, I should have seen for each nucleotide, much less than a millisecond.
Much less than
1 millisecond. I'll bring the numbers. There are really seminal experiments that measure how long it takes to transcribe this and that length of RNA. I'll bring the results. I think you even have them in the textbook. Yep. Third step, termination. So when the RNA polymerase meets some stop codon, the sequence that has to drop off to stop the elongation, when it reaches this site, then it dissociates from the DNA, and the completed RNA is then here. Okay, RNA molecules in the cell are usually single-stranded, such as messenger RNAs, and this is still thought to be the main fraction of RNAs in the cell, messenger RNAs, but other different types of RNA exhibit various conformational, also double-stranded RNA, and we have today we already know of a lot of types. Each year you have a new type of RNA, siRNA, piRNA, microRNA, which was discussed in this class. Short circular RNA. You have lots of fractions of RNA that thought to be sort of garbage in the cell, but now have function and are not garbage anymore, and are studied very extensively in neurobiology as well. But, yeah.
I have a question about the previous slide.
Yeah.
So you said that the RNA stops the transcription when it reaches the stop codon.
Right.
But as I recall, the codons are related to the translation, not the transcription.
It's not the codon, the stop determination site, you are right. Codon is the right.
So what stops the transcription?
The name of the sequence that stops the transcription?
No, how does the RNA know to stop the transcription? Not because of the stop codon.
What makes the transcription stop site or the sequence that sits right here dissociate the RNA polymerase from its site?
So, how come there are different,
I think slowing, I'm not sure.
Okay.
I think slowing down the RNA polymerase and then falls off, I'm not sure. For sure you have some consensus sequence, some characteristic of the sequence, but what does it cause the RNA polymerase to do?
Like the characteristic of the specific cell?
No, it's a generic feature as far as I know about RNA transcription. Again, you have some specific sequences here. You can refer to it as consensus sequences for termination, but if I understand your question correctly, so how these sequences, how do they cause the RNA polymerase to drop off?
Yeah.
To dissociate? Yeah, I'm not sure.
So different cells have different sequences that the RNA does transcription of?
From what I know, not really, not as a general thing. Termination sequences, as promoter sequences, so what you transcribe here right here is actually the genome, it's the same obviously in each cell. Right, so you have the same genome in each cell of your body, in very close resemblance between your genome and your friend's genome, just as well if you're in the same species. And the difference between different organisms, the difference between different cells is really in the transcriptome, in the population of RNA molecules that are in the cell, and hence the protein that are translated from them.
Okay,
so what terminates? Like, if you ask mechanistically what terminates the RNA polymerase, I should check. I think there are experiments that talk about slowing down of the RNA polymerase, and then dissociation occurs, maybe even.
What
do you mean by that? If it links, if you already. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Because you wouldn't say there would be no use for a stop codon in the translation if it already happens in the transcription.
So there's
and,
so one thing to yeah. Right. So okay. So that is important. RNA molecules are not complete one-to-one copies of what you have in the protein. So after DNA transcription, you will have fractions in the RNA that are translated, and in both ends you will have the 5 and 3 prime untranslated regions, or just UTRs, which stands for untranslated regions, which means exactly what it means, that are untranslated into protein. So only this part is in here you'll have the open reading frame that codes for sequence of amino acids and the protein. But that still doesn't answer
the question,
why did it stop here? So the mRNA stops here, but protein stops here, and you ask why the mRNA stops. Being synthesized here. So again, I'll have to come back to you with that.
Can these times be longer than a single coding?
This one, the 3 prime and 5 prime?
Yeah. Can they encode several proteins?
So, okay, so what do we call a gene? Philosophical question. Do we call it a region in the genome? Do we call it something that codes for RNA molecules that later be linked? Because there's some, maybe a bit esoteric, but still exist some cases in which so RNA molecules are processed in different ways. You know, maybe we leave it to the chapter that we'll study, I think, 4 classes from now, a lot about processes that change RNA. But to judge identify algorithms that are used to find new genes in de novo genomes of unknown organisms, right? Fished out some bacteria from inside the ocean, very deep. It's the first time you have the sequence, and then you want to know how many genes it has. So to judge by the algorithms, that would have to do that. So what the algorithms usually do is look at the promoter sequence, something that resembles something that will start, that will initiate a transcription, termination sequence, and a reading frame that will allow you to code continuously with no bumps. And there's a reservation here, but wait a minute, with the reservation, a certain length of amino acid sequence, or what we call an open reading frame to translation. And now, proteins before they are spliced, mRNAs before they are spliced, they actually also have regions that will not exist in proteins, and they are called introns. During the process of RNA processing, synthesizing, these introns are taken out of the molecules, and these regions are linked together. In the splicing reaction. Okay, so maybe a lot of things happen to, but I think this, you could find some disagreement even on this very basic thing as this question as what is a gene. But usually if you find a sequence in the genome that looks right, then you'll call it a gene. Okay, never mind. Back to this question of termination of RNA polymerase.
We still don't have the answer.
All right. So the RNA in the in the cell will be found in also in secondary structures. So their primary structure is this, just as in protein, sequence of nucleotides. And there are some local foldings of RNA on themselves, such as this one, it's called herpine, double helical stem loop, or stem region. This will be secondary structures, complementarity, pairing of complementary bases, usually closed one. And their tertiary structure, their spatial conformation, is also relevant sometimes. And here we see the 3D structure of secondary structure we call still a knot, because it looks like a knot. So it has some structure. This is okay. So let's move on. Yes, sorry.
Any connection with alpha helix of that sheet?
What do you mean? One of these again? What I'm saying right now is that RNA themselves are secondary and tertiary structures. Right? RNA molecules were synthesized, and before they were translated, we have not talked about translation yet. Is that okay?
Translation is a different structure than
those we discussed in proteins. True, and we won't really go into the interactions that are here. But generally saying that this is pairing between complementary bases. This is a base. This is a nucleic acid basing with the one right in front of it. Okay?
Those are hydrogen bonds?
There will be the same bonds that underline the interaction between the bases, meaning hydrogen and van der Waals, and also hydrophobic. Or what we call Watson Crick interaction. All right. Is it okay? You can ask if you want any question. Okay. Now we will move to translation, making a protein out of an RNA template. So this was just the messenger, and this is why we call it the messenger RNA. We have DNA, and then the messenger, which takes us to the next level of protein. And what we are looking at right here is the ribosome. Build of two main domains, big and small one. This is the messenger RNA, the template. Now that's the template of this protein, in opposed to the DNA template in the transcription. Now we have template messenger RNA from which you will code protein. Okay, and you have the secondary structure, that in one edge of it will hold an amino acid. Each one will hold a specific amino acid, and in the other, it has a three-letter code or a codon. Now we're dealing with codons. And each time on the messenger RNA, the ribosome will sit or recatalyze the complementarity between this codon or these three letters to the codon that exists on the messenger RNA, which will bring this amino acid in close proximity to this one, the last one that was linked. And what else the ribosome does is catalyze the peptide bond between this amino acid and the one that sits right here. All right. Yes. DNAs are also expressed from the genome, also transcribed from the genome.
There
is a difference in the process, but there's also, which we did not really discuss, but there's also a difference in the structure itself, as dictated by the sequence itself. Let's have a look at this sequence, for instance. So this is a piece of RNA that was transcribed from some region in the genome. Intrinsic, it wasn't taken from the outside, it's from your own genome. And so what will be the characteristic that you will have for these letters? If you have these letters right here, it will dictate, if you want to have a hairpin, it will dictate the identity of the letters right here. And there are sometimes what we call palindromes, sequence that can be read the same from one side and from the other, because they will sometimes give rise to hairpins and complementarity. So in lots of cases in RNA structures, it's enough for the primary structure to drive. But I will also say tRNA are indeed transcribed they have a certain pathway. For them it's more accurate. And we also, there's also a different pathway for what we call microRNA, which we will see. MicroRNA biogenesis differ from tRNA biogenesis, differ from mRNA biogenesis. This is all true, but they all exist right here in the cell. And now let's focus on how they give rise to translation. Okay, so based on the codon that was right here, the correct specific tRNA came, which holds a correct amino acid, which then linked to the growing polypeptide chain. All right, in a minute about the three-letter code, or what we call the genetic code. Before that, again, let's emphasize the three RNAs we have here. Messenger RNA, which is information processing or delivering maybe the information that was in DNA and passes it to this protein. tRNA, the sequence interpretation, because it sort of looks at this word, let's call it a word, it looks at this word and give it a meaning. So AAA will get this amino acid and UCG will get a different amino acid. So this is sort of the interpreter. And RNA, which is just part of the gray sphere, is part of the ribosome. Okay, this is very briefly protein translation.
And so the ribosome is entirely made out of RNA?
No, it's made of a lot of proteins,
okay.
And also of RNA molecules. It's a complex, it's made of proteins and RNA molecules.
But the rRNA doesn't really code for anything, right? It's the tRNA that actually does
the coding, right. The interpretation or the coding.
So the RNA is just there for the structure of the ribosome?
Right, it can be, I think, we shouldn't reduce it to be an enzyme, but it's sort of an enzyme. It catalyzes the reaction of polypeptide chain link right here, based on whatever was inserted based on the codon. So, right, it only catalyzes this reaction, which under certain conditions can take place spontaneously. Okay, this what we're looking at right now is the genetic code. This is how biologists decided to present it. We have the first letter in the code, in the three-letter code, the second and the third. So if you want to know what's the meaning of U, for instance, which amino acid will be inserted in or will be matched for such a codon, phenylalanine is the answer. U, C, C, for instance, the ringing is the answer, and so on and so forth. Okay, a few words about this table. First, we should have 64 combinations of three three-letter codes, right? Because we have three sites of four letters each. So four times four times four. And we have only 20 amino acids. So the code is degenerate to some extent, meaning that some codons will code for the same amino acid. And this is indeed what you see. So for instance, either UUU or UUC will code for the same amino acid, phenylalanine. Right. So this gives rise to what we call synonyms, which is different words in the language that have the same meaning. And the different words here are the different codons, UCU, UCC, or even UCA, and they will all have the same meaning, serine, or right here, serine. So it doesn't have to be the same first letter, because I gave you examples of only, they differ only in their last letter, but only different first letter. In other words, different codons can code for the same amino acid, but it's okay. It doesn't produce any mistakes because a certain code will still, codon will still give rise to only one specific amino acid, which another code, codon will also can interpret, can bring the same amino acid, but still each one means just one amino acid. Okay, second of all, in this table, note that some codons do not code for any amino acid. No amino acid is called stop, but some of them are called, but some of them call for termination of translation. They stop the translation process. Right? And if we say the word about the termination, the stop codon, that will always be UAA, UAG. Let's say something about the first codon that exists in only, that exists in all genes. So AUG is the start codon for all genes. So all proteins will always start with a methionine. Some, is anything in biology, some exceptions exist, but methionine will almost always start the protein. So we talked about synonyms and about stop and start codon.
Is there any reason why some amino acids have more possible combinations?
Some possible combinations?
Yeah, for example, serine has like six combinations,
yeah.
And some has less that have any. Are they more common, or does it have any reason why some
any reason? Maybe, well, I'm not sure if the question, it's a good question to begin with. I'm not sure if it's well defined yet. So if they're more common in the protein, I don't think so. I don't know of any experiments that were done to try to ask why some amino acids have more codons than others. I don't know.
It's more robust to errors.
More robust to
errors.
But then why some would have seven and some amino acids would only have two?
I don't know.
Yeah. Okay.
It might be possible reason might be that this particular protein is very important in here, and if we have an error in this sequence, we need to make sure it will be something like that.
I guess this must be someone who tried to link this to evolutionary processes, but then you can talk about advantage or disadvantage to organism. Not that I know it, but.
Yeah, I would think it's derived from side effects of evolutionary advantages.
Maybe. A bit of a hand waving, but sounds scientifically intuitive, all right. So, if we talk about evolution, let's just mention that this genetic code is true for all organisms. Translation, just as we described briefly the transcription process, let's say for translation. So, you're locked. So, not to into detail, but multiple initiation and elongation factors are required for this process. And not surprisingly, we again talk about series of chemical reactions and conformational changes between the players that allow this process. And now a bit more to the detail. So a ribosome will have two sites in its active site, EP and A. So the first is exit, and I'm not sure what the P and A stands for here. Okay, and the first amino acid, as we recall, is methionine, because the start codon on the mRNA codes on methionine. linkage, the peptide bond between these two will be formed by the ribosome right here, and then the two, okay, the peptide bond will be formed, and then the two will move to the ENP. They were here in the PNA site, and then move to ENP site, which the next step will be dissociation of this tRNA out of the complex, and entry of a new one, and then you have a linkage bond between these two amino acids. There are some cofactors here that let's ignore them for now. So obviously in the background, what you have is loading of tRNA with the correct amino acid, right? Any mistake in this process that happens in the background, and you don't see it in the slide, will cause mistakes, errors in the final sequence of amino acids right here, right? So it's an extremely regulated process, and complex back to the cytoplasm where it will be loaded with an amino acid. Okay, because we have time, so that's it for this chapter. I think we can either answer together the question page, which we still might do, but if I try to put this clip on, it doesn't always work. What it is the translation process, animation of the translation process, and it's based on the real crystallography structure. That Anna Jonas have allowed us to look at. So, if we want to know how things look like in the tissue during translation, maybe that's the best clip that we can look at to gain some intuition about how this process happens. Okay, ribosome in action. mRNA carrying the genetic code, approaching the small ribosomal unit, this is the ribosome. No longer gray. Okay, there are some initiating factors which we dropped off from our explanation. Another, and this is the tRNA charged or loaded with an amino acid. That's the first thing, the first tRNA goes in before the large subunit of the ribosome fits with the small one, and then, it's better or worse? Sorry. Right. You haven't seen anything by until now, right?
And maybe if you could.
Yeah, so again, the thing is that what we're looking at right here is a small subunit. Interacts already with the first tRNA. What does it have on it? It's a methionine. And only then the large subunit joins the body. It's a large subunit. It forms some bridges with the small one. The tRNA is still there, and then the second tRNA brings in the second amino acid, goes into the A site, and then you have the nascent protein, the growing protein. Okay. So it looks like a hand, like an arm right here, right? And an arm like here. But okay. It doesn't look real, right? But it's based on the crystallography structure that was for more than a decade validated with lots of experiments. Mutation experiments, lots of experiments, so structure is real. And the function you see here is based on, chemical or electric interaction between the atoms.
Protein is the purple one?
Right. The one, the glowing purple right here at the bottom is the protein, the nascent protein, the growing protein, and these are the tRNA, the leaves, and this is the template, messenger RNA. Everything glows from some reason. Note that the flip of the tRNA template, there is some small feature that was again validated with a specific experiment in the tRNA. They do some shift in while they exit their site in the ribosome. This is the growing protein. tRNA leaves without amino acid and will be loaded with new one. There's also the termination. Okay, stop codon reaches the coded decoding site, and here instead of an amino acid instead of a tRNA loaded with an amino acid, you have something that stops the termination, that stops the translation, and causes these two, the large and small domains of the ribosome, to dissociate, and lot of even antibiotics were already formed for old ones. Their mechanism were now are now known thanks to the structure, because they affect either the insertion of one tRNA or the association of the two subunits at the end of the process. So any of these steps can be affected by different antibiotics, and lots of them, as I said, lots of their mechanisms have been just now became known thanks to this structure. I think a good thing would be to answer the question page together right now. It's a really short one, right? Because we still have 2 minutes. That's it. Well, it's coding, yeah. siRNA. We haven't started, sorry, siRNA for the future. siRNA and rRNA.
Part of the ribosome.
Part of the ribosome, right. mRNA, typical messenger RNA.
Information
storage, correct. Here, right here, 5. mRNA and sRNA, small nuclear RNAs, we still haven't studied, so we will leave them. In the DNA molecule, A, the strand orientation is anti-parallel. Is that true?
Yes.
Right. The strand orientation is parallel. Not true. Covalent bonds hold the two strands together. Is that true? It's not non-covalent bonds. Hydrogen, hydrophobic, anything that's non-covalent, hydrogen bonds hold the two strands together. True. So we have A and B. F. Okay. That's it. For next week, you'll have to answer the protein structure and function question page and the article that I'll send you. Any questions? I didn't forget the question about termination of the article. Right. So I hear you. Anyone need anything from New York?
You're
going to New York for
3 days.
It's
going
to be painful. Yeah, it's a lot of
Thank you.
blood clot. And it was talking about it. About
the gamma old male? The Goshi means that?
אני חושב שזה סיבה של תפתח הרבה מהגן.